In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The Lord be with you. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Et intera pax hominibus omne voluntatis, laudamus se, et benedicimus se, adoramus se, glorificamus se, gratias agibus tibi, propter maia gloria tua. Domine Deus ex celestis, Deus Pater omnipotens, Domine Fili unigenite,
God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast kindle the faith of the people you have made your own, Increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. They devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to the communal life, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. All came upon everyone, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. All who believed were together and had things in common. They would sell their property and possessions and divide them among all according to each one's deed. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple area and to breaking bread in their homes. They ate their meals with exultation and sincerity of heart, praising God and enjoying favor with all the people. And every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gave us a new birth to a living hope, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by the power of God are safeguarded through faith, to a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the final time. In this you rejoice, although now for a little while you may have to suffer through various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that is perishable even though tested by fire, may prove to be for praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Although you have not seen him, you love him. Even though you do not see him, now yet believe in him. You rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy as you attain the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side, and do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Our Lord is a perfect gentleman. He never forces himself, he never forces his love on anyone. It is not simply a matter of his infinite courtesy and gracious way, though he is flawlessly polite and kind. When St. John tells us in his first letter that God is love, the apostle reveals something of the inner life of God. He is a communion of love, three persons united in perfect self-giving. For self-giving to be perfect, it must be completely self-forgetful and at the service of the other. St. Thomas Aquinas called such love benevolence, benevolentia, literally to will the good of the other. Now, benevolence, or charity, as we call it, though diffusive of itself, according to Thomas, like light spreads itself and continues as far as it goes. Like charity, love is diffusive of itself. Its nature is to share, to spread itself. And it is always of its nature, personal, directed or offered to this person or to that person. And that means that love, when it is true, always considers the individual, his or her capacity to understand and to receive love. The authentic approach of the heart to someone is shaped or tailored, if you like, to his or her personality and circumstances. We never want to overwhelm someone, for instance, and this instinct comes from God, who will not overwhelm us, but who shapes or tailors his love, his approach, his mercy to us in courtesy, yes, but more importantly, to preserve our free and our full response. Our free and our full response. Think of it this way. The joy of a wedding flows from the fact that the bride and the groom want to marry each other, to give themselves to each other freely and fully, and not because there is any constraint, coercion, or force. In fact, the priest responsible for the couple's preparation for marriage must verify that each party approaches the other in freedom and in peace. Otherwise, he cannot witness their vows. Said another way, without freedom, there is no true love. Within the Sacred Heart of Jesus is a personal love, a benevolence for each of us, tender, gentle, and disposed towards the individual circumstance of each person, each heart. Of course, this impulse flows from his humility as well as his intimate knowledge of every person. He knows the best approach to our hearts, the one that will produce the desired response to his love, which builds up all of us in love and in truth, always respecting the freedom that he has already shared with us. Think back to Easter Sunday a week ago. St. Paul put it very beautifully in the second reading for that Mass when he said that our life, each of us, is hidden in the heart of Christ in God. That from the chapter 3 of Colossians. Jesus knows how to lift our hearts from sorrow and shame and then to unite those hearts to his in joy. Jesus knows when we have lost our peace through sin and infidelity, when we are anxious or frightened, when we are humiliated in our failure and weakness. By way of example, on this Feast of the Divine Mercy, let us think of St. Peter, the Prince of the Apostles. We know the story of his denial, in spite of his assurance to the Master that he would always remain faithful. On the first Easter Sunday, Peter walks into the empty tomb, and he observes what remains now that Jesus has gone. But as the Gospel records, Peter still did not understand. Something caused him to hesitate. Something remained to be done before he could stand and speak with the fire and conviction that we have heard this past week in the Acts of the Apostles during the octave of Easter. In fact, Peter himself will tell us At the end of that marvelous confession of faith that's recorded in the Acts of the Apostles in chapter 10, exactly what he still needed personally, and it was the forgiveness of his sins. So in the gospel story, we will soon see, this is chapter 20 of St. John's Gospel that we heard from this morning on Divine Mercy Sunday. We will soon see in the next chapter, 21 of St. John, the encounter between Jesus and Peter where the master frees his beloved student from the burden of his guilt and pain by allowing the Prince of the Apostles to be true to his temperament, spontaneous, impulsive, bold. Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Peter always is ready to do something for Christ, in this case, to lead the flock and to feed it, and in time, truly ready to offer his life after the example of his beloved Lord, and in freedom, all in freedom, a perfect self-gift, where self means the individual created in the image and likeness of God, with all of his or her unique and special traits and gifts. The Feast of the Divine Mercy. Do you recall during Holy Week on Holy Thursday how our Lord instituted the Holy Eucharist, the priesthood, and the sacred mystery that binds the two of them together, the Holy Mass? Today, the Lord institutes the sacrament of penance, as we have heard in the Gospel. And do you see also how he closely connected the meeting today in the upper room with the apostles after his resurrection with Good Friday? Thomas had said, I'm not going to believe until I put my hands into his side and I see the mark of the nails in his hands. And Jesus comes and stands before them and says, peace be with you. And he says to Thomas, verify my wounds. Verify them for yourself by putting your finger here and see that I suffered for you and offered for you my life on the cross. And so, dear friends in the Lord, for us the connection is plain. The suffering of the Savior on the cross on Good Friday leads to the mercy of God poured out upon the apostles and on us here in John chapter 20, now on Divine Mercy Sunday. Our Lord has instituted the sacrament of forgiveness, of mercy, of penance, when he says, receive the Holy Spirit, whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you are retained. He says, as the Father has sent me, so I send you to do the same. Here, our Lord enters into our hearts more deeply and fully through the grace of the Paschal Mystery. He has given us what we need to approach him always with confidence and love. Jesus knows what is in your heart and mine. He knows what is in every individual heart. He sees through the tangle of our own making, of sin and infidelity, our anxiety, our confusion, our negligence, our malice, our indifference. He sees through the tangle of all of those things to the purity and the perfection that his grace will achieve if we but in freedom will say yes. He trusts in the power of human love, aided by his grace, to respond to divine love, not just in the universal sense, but also in the particular, in the personal, in this man, in this woman, in this disciple, and in that one. And so, if Jesus trusts in us, can we not trust in him? O Jesus, I trust in you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit
was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters, filled with paschal joy, let us pray more earnestly to God that he who graciously listened to the prayers and supplications of his beloved Son may now be pleased to look upon us in our lowliness.
For the Church, that on this Divine Mercy Sunday, she will rededicate herself to living and proclaiming Christ's mercy, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those that God is calling to the priesthood, religious and consecrated life, that they may not doubt the Lord's presence in their life, but believe and respond with an outpouring of faith and generosity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all those trapped in confusion or doubt, that they may be filled with the truth and the light of the risen Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially those suffering from COVID-19, that they may be healed and consoled by the glorified wounds of Christ crucified, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the dead, especially those who have died from COVID-19, that they may be washed clean from the blood and water which gushed forth from the side of Christ as a fount of mercy for us, that they may partake in the glory of the resurrection. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And especially during this sacred time, for an increased availability of the sacrament of penance, for a greater devotion to this sacrament of God's mercy, and for the great healing, peace, and freedom that it will bring to many souls, we pray to the Lord. O God, who knows that our life in this present age is subject to suffering and need, hear the desires of those who cry to you and receive the prayers of those who believe in you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But on this day above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world, and by dying has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic host sing together the hymn of your glory as they acclaim.
Sanctus,
Sanctus.
Sanctus
Dominus Deus Salvo. Veni sunt celi et tua, Hosanna in excelsis. Benedictus qui venit in nomine Therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Frank, our Bishop, and all those who holding to the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers and all things we may be defended by your protecting help through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for those to whom you have been pleased to give the new birth of water and the Holy Spirit, granting them forgiveness of all their sins. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. And with eyes raised to heaven to you, God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei,
tuum annunciamus Domine, et tuam resurrectione confitemur, Domine veni.
Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them, as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. Humble prayer we ask, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing through Christ our Lord. Amen. We're also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon through Christ our Lord. Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day. That by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace in unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal Sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and hearts through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Ite missa est, alleluia, alleluia.
Deo gratias, alleluia, alleluia.
Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray, And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan, all evil spirits, who prowl throughout the world seeking the ruin of souls.